John, John. I can't do this one without him.
No. Where'd we go?
I don't know. Good morning.
Good morning, darling.
John Talon, are you here? Paging John Talon?
I think we lost him.
Okay.
It's showtime.
Okay.
Well, we're waiting for our drummer.
Just one second. I have to wait for John. I don't know where he is. Maybe he's in the restroom. Okay. Are you coming up here, Michelle?
For the opening?
If I start just wandering around the sanctuary...
I'll grab you and pull you in. You betcha. I got
like,
you,
Michelle,
darling.
Over here, honey. Over here.
Is he there?
Come join us.
We got to start. It's after 10. Okay. I'm sorry. I didn't know where you were. Okay.
Paging John Talon.
Okay. Are you ready?
So good morning.
Good morning.
As an affirmation for peace in the Middle East, and in solidarity with our Muslim and Jewish brothers and sisters, all of us people of the book, we greet one another. Assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
Peace be upon you.
And upon you, peace.
Shalom Aleichem.
Aleichem Shalom.
I'm Reverend Vicky Elder, and it's my joy and honor to welcome you to Unity of Monterey Bay, a beloved community co-created with love and intention. Whether you're here with us in person or joining us virtually, we know that love knows no boundaries. We are one in spirit. And as we open and embrace this life in this moment, let us affirm, thank you, God, for this most amazing day. Miracle follows miracle, and wonders never cease. Unity of Monterey Bay is an inclusive spiritual community committed to co-creating an environmentally sustainable, spiritually fulfilling, socially just, and compassionate human presence on this planet. We celebrate our oneness and honor the God of each of our understanding, affirming the innate good and divine essence within each and every individual. Will you please join me in our statement of faith? There is only one presence and one power in the universe, God the good, expressing as infinite God beyond us, intimate God beside us, inner God being us, divine love in action. And this morning, let us deepen our focus and envision a world that works for all. Mother, Father, God, Spirit, Creator, One, God of many names and faces, in a world that is changing so rapidly and facing so many challenges, let us take this moment to expand our awareness and our compassion to consider how these changes and challenges are affecting all of us. Knowing that feeling of fear and insecurity can quickly overwhelm feelings of peace, we recognize that as peace seems further and further away, it is easy to drift into isolation and discord. So in this moment, let us pray and reclaim peace by remembering who we are, divine beings, beloved children of God. And let us include all of the world's people in our prayers, envisioning us coming together in harmony to co-create a peaceful world that works for all. And so it is. And now we're at that time in our service that we bless our children. And I think the kids are just now regularly just going downstairs. So you can just envision and feel their energy as they're in the building, as we say. And I invite you to just bring the other children in your own life to mind, your children, your nieces and nephews, grandchildren, the children in your neighborhood, the children in our community, and the children around the world as we join in our blessing. We love you. We bless you. We appreciate you just the way you are.
Take some moments to center ourselves and deepen our blissful inner connection with spirit. Taking a deep breath in and letting it out with an audible sigh, we allow all distractions to gently fade away as we invite the chime to call us into the sacred space within. We ring the chime four times to call in the four directions and to remind us of our interconnection with all of creation and with the sacred circle of life. As we feel it resonate through our very beings, we follow its call into this now present moment within. Continuing to focus on our breath, with each inhale, we open our hearts and minds. We envision our breath reaching every cell of our being. And with each exhale, we see all barriers and obstacles dissolving into the divine flow. And again, as we inhale, we expand the spaciousness within us. We move beyond the limitations and boundaries of our bodies. And as we exhale, we ground ourselves deep within Mother Earth and into our oneness with the universe. Finally, we breathe our awareness into the highest expression of love, light, joy, and peace we can imagine, as we experience a transforming wave of gratitude. And with a fullness of heart, we say yes to it all, embracing, claiming, and knowing the divine Christ Spirit expressing in, through, and as us. And with a final exhale, we say, thank you, God. So now, fully centered and transformed by the power of Spirit, we enter into our lesson and meditation time with today's daily word.
We read from the January 31st, 2022 Daily Word, shared with permission of Unity Publisher of Daily Word, that can also be found at dailyword.com. And the word is grace. I invite you to allow my words to be your words. The grace of God flows freely through me. Within the turbulence of a storm exists the delicate beauty and perfection of the raindrop. Filled with renewing, cleansing water, each drop contains the nourishing promise of new life. I can think of grace the same way. No matter the storm, the presence of God within it, vibrantly alive and discoverable in every detail. When life's hurricanes arrive, infinite grace shelters me from the deluge. It is easier to weather a downpour if I am prepared and protected. So I step confidently into the powerful shelter of my faith. Mindful of my every blessing, I cherish all the gratitude and grace I can find. I don't simply ride out the storm, I go through it, appreciating the power and majesty of each precious drop of rain. And from the scriptures, from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. John chapter 1, verse 16. In witness to the wisdom of the many paths to the sacred, We read from three sacred traditions on this morning's topic, baptism in beloved community. From Buddhism, it is possible that the next Buddha will not take the form of an individual. The next Buddha may take the form of a community, practicing understanding and loving kindness and mindful living. From Judaism, I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your impurities and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. From Christianity. And so John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem went out to him, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." Mark chapter 1, verses 4 and 5, and 9 and 11.
Take a hand, come, give your heart, come, as you are, come, 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 lift your voice, come, shine your light, come, now is the time, come, come.
Most of you, or those of you here, can see that we have something going on here that isn't normally here. And this morning, we're going to be exploring the ancient ritual of baptism, specifically the Christian sacrament of baptism. Now, I'm sure there's at least some of you who are wondering why. Maybe even SYH, which I recently learned from my 13-year-old grandson means shaking your head. I keep learning these things from him. We're texting a lot, so I guess that's a good thing. And I'm guessing that most of us here, in person and virtually, were baptized or christened. Can I show a hand? And I'm also assuming that few of us have given much thought to what that meant to our parents or the church community where it happened, or perhaps more importantly, what it means, if anything, to us today. So why are we, or I guess more accurately, why am I talking about baptism today? Well, like many of my lesson topics, it seems to have chosen me rather than the other way around. As most of you know, I was blessed with a new granddaughter, Rory Rose, last year, and I have a new grandson, Lennon Joseph, due in March. And that's caused me to think more about baptism than I normally do, as in wondering whether Kyle and Justine will want to baptize Rory and Lennon, and why or if it matters to me. It also came up last year when my son Travis asked me for his baptism certificate, which he needed to get married in our local Catholic church last October. He wasn't required to convert to Catholicism, and he didn't, but he did need proof that he'd been baptized. I was actually surprised that it didn't matter by what church. Travis's Unity Certificate of Christening fulfilled the requirement, but it made me again think about baptism. And then, over the past 2 months, two people within our Unity community asked me if I would baptize them. I said yes, of course, and my original plan was to include their baptism ritual within today's Sunday service, but not have it necessarily be the focus of the service, because today was supposed to be our annual calling the circle day. That's a day we focus on community, and it seemed appropriate to have a baptism ritual then. So with all of that backdrop, I began to consider what an appropriate ritual for an adult baptism would involve. I asked the two individuals what baptism was representing to them, in essence, what they were seeking in the experience. And I also reflected on what baptism for my grandchildren meant to me. What was I seeking in that experience? And I realized before I could conduct this service or ask Kyle and Justine to consider it for Rory and Lennon, that I needed to do some spiritual discernment about what baptism means to me today. As a Unity minister who is now a baptizer, as a parent who chose to have all three of my children baptized, as a grandma or jaja, as they call me, considering why or whether it's important to me that my grandchildren be baptized, and finally, as one who was baptized. Of course, I am clear and still grounded in our Unity understanding that baptism is not about cleansing us from original sin, because we're not fallen beings, but rather evolving ones. Nor is it a requirement to enter into the kingdom of God or the beloved community or be dedicated to following Jesus' teachings of radical love. In other words, I know a lot about what baptism isn't to me, but I want to be more grounded in what I believe it is and why it's meaningful to practice it today. So that when we share the experience, it serves as something that touches us deeply, something sacred and meaningful. And as so often happens when I'm called to take a deep dive into a spiritual question, I bring you all along with me. So as I teach what I most need to learn. As I began my research, I was guided to a sermon by Ellen Sims, a United Church of Christ minister whose thoughts on baptism fully resonated with me. Specifically, she suggested that one reason progressive Christians value the sacraments, in essence, baptism and communion, is because sacraments, like art, hold a rich capacity for multiple meanings and thus can, to an extent, be personalized. In short, dogma gets frozen into rules and truth claims that pinpoint meanings, whereas sacraments are let loose into the world of experience as we each enter into them, where they grow and expand and thus enlarge meanings. St. Augustine, back in the 4th century, defined a sacrament as an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual grace. I like one Lutheran minister's interpretation of that when she said, a sacrament uses ordinary stuff like water, wine, and bread to make God's grace visible and tangible. And there it is. This is why we do rituals. Sacraments like baptisms and communion and wedding ceremonies and celebrations of life, they help us move from our heads to our hearts and to experience the life-giving and freeing grace of God in a present moment and within a community, and to help bestow that on another. So let's take a moment and breathe right now into that thought, feeling our awareness drop right now from our heads to our hearts, and feeling our hearts open as we ground ourselves in this now moment of love and life and presence and joy. So the truth is, as we've just experienced, we don't necessarily need rituals to know God in this moment. Nevertheless, rituals do serve to help create a shared collective experience of God, offering the transformative power of community, which comes from the same root as communion. But for our rituals to be effective, for them to touch into our hearts and minds and souls, I believe we need to reflect, co-create, and embrace a common understanding of the sacred symbolism and meaning behind the ritual, even as we may each have our own unique experience within it. And to do that, I find it helpful to trace a ritual back to its origins, before it became laden with dogma, and thus still holds a rich capacity for multiple meanings that can invite us into our own sacred experiences. The originating Christian story about baptism comes from the stories told in the Gospels about John the Baptist and the baptism of Jesus, which Robin read from the book of Mark. I often use the Gospel of Mark because it was the earliest written record, so I often feel like it's the most authentic. The others began to be flourished with the church's views and religion and such, so we started there. But as progressive Christian Lutheran pastor Reverend Don Hutchins explains, when we look back to the stories told in the Synoptic Gospels about the baptism of Jesus, we are sometimes so distracted by the opening of the heavens, the descent of the dove, and the voice of God declaring Jesus to be the beloved, that we miss an important detail of the way in which the early followers of the way chose to tell the story of Jesus' public coming out party. New Testament scholars remind us that the stories told by the writers of the Gospels were written at the end of the first century, a time when it would have been clear to all those who had ears to hear that going down to the River Jordan to be baptized by John the Baptist would have stirred up the political and religious waters of the day. Meaning, as UCC Pastor Sims explains, baptism is not just between Jesus and us individually. Baptism has larger political meaning and consequences. For example, the writer of the Gospel of Luke takes great pains to set the political backdrop for Jesus' baptism. Most of John's followers were the poor and marginalized, but he also was getting followers from some tax collectors and soldiers who the empire counted on to exploit the poor. John demanded that even the poor share with those less fortunate than themselves, saying, "Whoever has two coats must share with anyone who has none, and whoever has food must do likewise." He told the tax collectors who wanted to be baptized that they must stop being complicit with the empire. And to the Roman soldiers who sought him out, those who were used to enforce the tax collectors' demands, he said, "You can't be baptized until you turn around. So stop threatening people or lying about them in order to extort more money." Remember, the Greek word for repent actually means to turn around and go in the opposite direction. John the Baptist was clearly a revolutionary who never tried to disguise or conceal his condemnation of the religious and political authorities for leading the people down the wrong path. He did, however, stay preaching out in the wilderness, not in the streets of Jerusalem. But by calling the people to repent, he was literally calling them to join a revolution designed to overthrow the status quo. And all of this established a political context for Jesus' baptism. By going down to the river Jordan and submitting to John's baptism of repentance, Jesus was choosing to identify himself with political revolution that directly challenged the religious and political domination institutions of his time. And Hutchings adds that the writers of the Gospels chose to tell their story in ways that see the God of Israel give Jesus a shout out and the very Spirit of God descend like a dove onto his shoulders turns John's baptism of repentance into a kind of passing the torch from one revolutionary to the next, especially because John would soon be arrested and executed by Herod. Nevertheless, despite having cast Jesus into the role of revolutionary torchbearer, none of the Gospels portray Jesus following the ways of his predecessor. There's no record of Jesus calling people to repent, nor is there any record of Jesus ever having baptized anyone. And even his vision of revolution, in essence, radical love, was unique to him. Indeed, having Jesus head off into the wilderness immediately following his baptism to find his own way prepares us to follow Jesus down a completely different path than that of his predecessor. Looking back upon the baptism of Jesus from this perspective, Hutchins challenges us, surely we can take courage from Jesus' example of wandering off into the wilderness to find our own way of challenging the religious and political authorities of our day. In short, Christian baptism was not originally an occasion to bless a baby with sweet words and high hopes for his or her future. Jesus accepted a baptism and subsequent path that set him against the powers of domination. Baptism in this light was never meant to be a mark of conformity, but one of disrupting the status quo to help usher in the kingdom of God. And there has never been a time so clearly in need of repentance, disruption, and transformation. Though I'm guessing we could say that about any point in history, but we're living in this one, and the call is to us and now. So I've reflected on how we might co-create a sacrament of baptism that embraces the revolutionary love of our wayshower and using ordinary stuff to demonstrate the life-giving and freeing experience of God's grace in visible and tangible ways, both for us as individuals, for Raj and Andrea, who were the ones who asked me to do a baptism, and for all of us as the beloved community, holding the space and participating in the commitment. So we begin with water, the very stuff of life. Most religious traditions have understood the element of water as the great purifier, that which washes clean and makes new. It is the teacher of mysteries, of life and death and rebirth. Springs, streams, rivers, creeks, lakes, ponds, pools, and oceans are compassionate healers, relieving actual and metaphoric thirsts. It's no coincidence that many of us find solace and comfort sitting by a river or sitting at the ocean or immersing ourselves in a hot bath or any other form of connecting with water, and that we're, what is it, 90%+ water ourselves. Water in our lives is the power of purification, the healing balm of compassion, and the great mystical presence of creativity and connection. Water is a conduit that also connects us all together. The word baptize means to submerge or immerse. So when a baptism is discussed, it involves a person being totally submerged into something else. And being totally submerged implies being all in. Thus, baptism infers that a change takes place. In essence, baptized people are changed people. Metaphysically, according to Charles Fillmore in The Revealing Word, the two baptisms of John, of water, and Jesus, of spirit, represent the two common steps in spiritual development, denial and affirmation. or the dropping of the old and the laying hold of the new. Practically, to embrace, in essence, to commit to the practice of denials and affirmations is to commit ourselves to developing our capacity for mindfulness by healing and releasing error thoughts that get in the way of us experiencing the presence, love, and peace of God, and by embracing truth through regular prayer, meditation, and principled thinking and action. In essence, with the sacrament of adult baptism, we're awakening and committing to making straight the way of the Lord. In other words, we're going all in to open and align our minds and hearts with God. But again, more than just a personal journey or commitment, baptism is essentially a communal experience. It is a dedicating our lives to God by becoming part and co-creating a beloved community, making a sacred commitment to love one another, which includes continually calling one another and ourselves to wake up, grow up, clean up, and show up. As for infant and child baptisms, the focus is clearly on the adults, in essence, the family and community that is gathering around that child and making the commitment. In its ideal form, it becomes the highest demonstration of the village being willing to show up for all of our children. But it's also a gift to the community, because the birth of any child opens our hearts to the miracle of life. And sharing in a baptism ritual helps remind us of our connection to something greater than ourselves. As we each add our blessings to the living waters of baptism, we can see beyond the drops of water to the very stuff that nourishes, grounds, and sustains us in this life, and also to the possibilities of what life might become if we truly loved one another. So this is the calling of baptism. I'm inviting us all into on this morning as a beloved community, saying to all, just like the song, come, take a hand. Come, give your heart. Come, lift your voice. Shine your light. See what love has done. For as we gather in this sacred place, Spirit meets us face to face. So this morning, I'm going to be inviting us all to dip our hands into the living water of baptism. If you're joining us virtually, you might want to take this opportunity to prepare a bowl of water so you can join us in the ritual as it unfolds. Following the meditation, we will baptize Rajiv Parti, who is here, and Andrea Moore, who is participating virtually, and anyone else who is feeling called to be baptized or to renew their baptism this morning. It will involve also all the rest of us, creating the beloved community, which is equally important to this experience, holding sacred space, affirming our commitment to love one another, and in that love to continually call each other higher. And so we begin with our meditation.
Blessed are
invite you to settle in as we devote the next few moments to quiet communion and contemplation and reflection. So bringing your awareness into your body, becoming aware of your breath as you inhale and exhale. Breathing deeply, slowing your breath down, slowing your body down, slowing your thoughts down, and allowing yourself to just arrive in this now, here, present moment. Feel the sensations in your body. Feel the air around you. The presence of others around you. The surface beneath you rising up to support you. And breathing in again deeply. And as you exhale, just relaxing and letting go. Letting go, letting be. I invite you now to just begin to reflect gently on the lesson that we just had about baptism. Just allowing whatever comes up for you to be just as it is. Just letting it be there, whatever thoughts or feelings or reactions. Letting it all belong, letting it all have a place. And I invite you to begin to reflect now on what it means to you to be part of this beloved community. What does it mean to you to join with others each Sunday morning? To remind one another, to remind ourselves that we are spiritual beings having a human experience. As Vicky mentioned, to interrupt that normal flow of our life and set aside time for the sacred. I invite you to reflect on our collective commitment as the beloved community, our commitment to love one another. As Jesus, our way shower, demonstrated, and as he commanded us to do, first and foremost, to love one another. What does it mean to you to be part of a community that is committed to holding ourselves and one another to this highest standard of love and compassion? And now I invite you to reflect on your own baptism, if you did, in fact, have one, and what it meant to you, what it means to you today. Can you understand this ritual as an outer demonstration of an inner process, an inner grace, an inner commitment to awakening? invite you to reflect on your own individual commitment to yourself, to following the way that Jesus taught. Your commitment to yourself to put God first in your life, to put your own spiritual growth first in your life. Your own commitment to practice being in the world but not of it. And to living into that revolutionary love that Jesus demonstrated. So having reflected on our individual and our communal commitments, I now invite you to imagine dipping your hands into these sacred waters and letting the waters of the earth remind you what a gift your life is. Letting the waters of life remind you of the love that flows in, with, through, and beyond you. Letting the waters of baptism soothe you, nourish you, and sustain you for all the possibilities yet to come. For we are the beloved children of creation that rejoices in our very being. And if you listen closely, you just might hear the flapping of the wings of a dove as the Holy Spirit alights upon you. Do not be afraid. Just rest in God and say amen.
So Raj, would you come forward? And anyone else who would like to be baptized or to renew their baptism this morning? And we're thinking of Andrea, who's joining us virtually. And if there's anyone else who virtually would like to participate in this baptism service, please share your full name in the chat with a brief statement about what baptism means to you, why you want to take this step this morning. And I ask the rest of us to continue to hold this sacred space that Michelle so lovingly established with the meditation as we set a collective intention with this song.
My heart
Raj, would you go to the mic and please share your full name and what this ritual means to you this morning?
Hi, I'm Rajiv Pardi, and I go by the name Raj. The reason I'm getting baptized, because about 12 years ago, I had a near-death experience when I nearly died during prostate cancer surgery. And in my near-death experience, I went to hell first, then heaven, and experienced the light and Jesus Christ. And I was told to follow Jesus Christ, though I'm a Hindu by birth, to spread his message of universal love and forgiveness. And why unity? Because deep in my heart, my consciousness believes in the unity principles. Like the Jesus Christ I experience is the same Christ within me. And my message is to spread Christ consciousness. And heaven and hell are not physical entities outside, but different levels of consciousness in our own mind. Thank you.
And Michelle, would you share? Andreas?
So these are Andrea's words. I want to feel and acknowledge the spirit within me, being witnessed by others. Something brief but taken slowly for those moments, to be present with gratitude, surrender, and whatever else comes up. It feels like a special symbolism that I'd like to complete, maybe creating a new place for contemplation.
Were there anybody that, Jan, would you share?
Yes, Kathy Pomeroy. She wishes to read a poem for connection to others.
Okay. All right. So having heard the intentions of these individuals who are receiving this baptism ritual, let us deepen our centering with a cleansing breath as we begin opening our hearts to the presence of Spirit. In the name of Father, Divine Mind, Principle, and in the name of the Mother, Source of Life, from whom water flows and to whom water returns, Infinite God beyond us. In the name of the Son, and in the name of the Daughter, Flesh and Blood, in whom we meet the Divine, born of the physical water of childbirth and the subtle water of Spirit, Intimate God beside us. In the name of the Spirit, the Word, Divine wisdom, ideal formless form, wind that moves water, unseen energy, bliss of creativity, inner God being us. We lift up this sacred water, gathered from our Monterey Bay, and also a bit of water that I brought back from Ireland, from St. Bridget's Sacred Well. And we invite the beloved community to now add their blessings to this water with a word of intention, a gift from your heart. If you're here, you can speak it out loud. If you're virtually with us, this is the time that I would invite you to touch the water that you've prepared and come up with a word that you would like to add, knowing that the water that you're holding is connected to all water and to this water. And then share your word in the chat. And are there there any words from the chat? So we just take all these gifts and we see this water being imbued with these gifts and we're us all being connected in this process. And we're going to symbolize this baptism with a hand cleansing and an anointing of oil. And so, Raj, you can just put your hands over the... There's a towel right there. And Michelle's going to anoint you.
I anoint you in the name of the infinite God beyond you, intimate God beside you, inner God being you, divine love in action.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Thank you.
We see all that obscures God from your soul have been washed away so that you may become a clear, clean mirror reflecting the presence of the divine. With this water, we awaken you to your divine nature, ordain you to works of service and compassion, and affirm your intention to grow in love for God and all beings. And we now invite the community to join in a collective response. We rejoice with you in your deepening understanding of faith and discipleship. We promise you our continuing friendship and prayers as we share in this journey, hopes, and labors of the universal beloved community. We see you filled with the strength for life's journey, courage in times of suffering, the joy of faith, the freedom of love, and the hope of new life in the Christ Spirit that makes us one. And let us pray. Your waters, O God, are ever bracing and refreshing. May we continue to find our ways to plunge into the currents of change, to trustingly yield to your buoyancy of your care, to surface again with vigor for a new day. We pray in the name of Jesus, who entered a beloved tradition and altered it with integrity. May we do the same. Amen and amen.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, people who are online.
Welcome. Thank you.
Welcome, Raj. It's wonderful to have you.
I forgot one thing. One thing. Here's your certificate of baptism, and also you can take a blessing card and a heart to remember this day.
Unity of Monterey Bay is the collective consciousness and commitment of all of us who give of our time, treasure, and talent in order to sustain the spiritual community that is dedicated to transforming lives. We know that prosperity is a state of mind that finds blessings in every situation and abundance in joyous generosity. We transform all appearance of fear or lack into a faith-filled peace of mind by shifting our attention to thoughts of gratitude for the abundance of God's good in our lives. And with our hearts and minds overflowing with gratitude, we breathe into the divine flow of God's good, trusting that we are enough, that we have enough, and that there always is enough to both have and to share. And again, we are grateful to all of you for your online giving through our website at unityofmontereybay.org and through your mailed-in offerings, including those who have set up automatic giving with your banking institutions. We are truly blessed. I'll get there. We were just discussing the fact that today is our fifth Sunday of the month, which each quarter we have a one-fifth Sunday, and today is our building Sunday. As some of you may know, our beloved building always needs a little extra TLC, and the board is making some discussions right now on prioritizing these needs. So any extra above and beyond your normal tithe would be truly, truly appreciated. For those of you who are here in person, the baskets are still in the back by the door for you to drop your offering as you leave this morning. We're still not passing them, so there's one in the center and one by the door. And now, from this place of faith and gratitude, I invite you to join me in mindful intention and joining in our offertory blessing. I am an open channel for God's infinite good. Divine love flowing through me blesses and multiplies everything I give and everything I receive. I am both blessed and a blessing. Thank you, God.
Thank you.
So the musicians whose music we use today, we want to thank them. So a lot of Denise Rosier today, always. And Ricky Byers, and of course Daniel Namod. And our awesome music team, and Robin and for Michelle, singing, and John Denise and John Talon on drums. So for announcements today, we refer you to our e-blast for all of the various things going on and coming up. But this is a reminder that the highway cleanup is going to be next weekend on Saturday and Sunday. And I think John wants to say something. John is our new highway cleanup person. Yay! Well, not new, but sort of new.
Yeah, we're having it next weekend. Saturday will be 9 o'clock. We're meeting at the 76 station in Castorville.
Shell.
And on Sunday, we'll meet right after service at the same place. Wonderful news. We're going to be getting a stipend of $250 every month. When we go out there, you know, the work that we do and the pickup, you know, the cleanup that we do. So that's awesome. There's some criteria that we need to follow, but that's, you know, some photographs they want and a few things here and there. That's easy. We can follow that.
Yeah.
And the third one was Howard actually was out there one Saturday, and a resident in the area stopped and said how wonderful it was that we were out there cleaning up the area, and we were making an impact. It's a real impact that we're doing in that section of highway that we have. People really appreciate the work that we do, and we're all volunteers, and we love that area. I mean, it's just, that's our spot, and people are appreciating it, so that's awesome. Mm-hmm. And that's it. Okay. Come on out.
Yay. Thank you.
And thank you so much, John Dundon, for stepping up to be the sort of leader of that team, and thank you everyone who has gone out to do that. It does really make a difference. There's a lot of garbage out there, unfortunately, so we are so grateful for that service. And hey, $250 a month, not too shabby, right? So as we bring our service to a close this morning, we want you to know how grateful we are that you have joined us here, whether you're here in person or you're joining us virtually or even watching at another time later on YouTube. We just hope that we've made you feel at home in our Unity of Monterey Bay community, and we want you to know that wherever you are on your spiritual journey, you are welcome here. Chaplain today is Robin, so Robin is available to pray with you after the service for your prayer needs or prayer joys that you would like to see expanded in consciousness, and you can also drop a prayer request in the wooden box by the door. Prayer requests can be submitted on our website as well. And all the prayers that come in through these various channels are prayed over by our prayer chaplain team, which is always holding the high watch for this community. So we are grateful for their service. With all of that, we're ready to form our closing circle for our prayer for protection and our peace song.
I'd also just like to remind the women to check the e-blast because we have changes happening around our women's retreat, and we have some questions in the e-blast, and we have feedback from all of you. So if you're a woman that has gone to a women's retreat or would like to go to a women's retreat, please check last week's e-blast. It'll be in there again this week, and let us know. All right, thank you.
So I just want to say congratulations to Raj and to Andrea for the commitment that they've made here this morning, and anyone else who has inwardly made that commitment. We are honoring you today, and we are grateful to be able to hold this space. We made a circle. So holding this beloved community in our hearts, will you please join me in our prayer for protection? The light of God surrounds us. I am light. The love of God enfolds us. I am love. The power of God protects us. I am power. The presence of God watches over us. I am presence. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.